Good morning. Welcome to Church Online. We're so glad that you're joining us this morning. It's so good to be able to come into your homes this morning on this wonderful Sunday morning, Pentecostal Sunday. It's exciting. Just a few announcements before we move into our worship service. Just wanted to let you know that we do have our in-person services at 10:30 on Sunday morning, same time as you click on to watch service. We have services here on campus. We also have our Lita Kids classes, which is pre-K all the way to junior high classes. So if you haven't joined us yet, I would just recommend come joining us here on campus. We have a lot going on. It's so awesome to come together in the house of worship, amen. I do want to invite you to our prayer night Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. If you have not joined us, I'd recommend joining us. We do send out an email blast on Tuesdays with the information to log on. If you're not getting our emails, go on to arlitafirst.org and sign up for those emails. They're there. It's an awesome time to come together in prayer. We had a sister who recently came to the church, and it was really exciting because she was started joining the women's ministry prayer night on Wednesday night, and there was some health issues that were coming up. She went to the doctors. It's so amazing. She came onto campus one Thursday as I was driving out. And, you know, she was with excitement, Pastor Tony, I've been going to prayer nights on Wednesday nights with the women, and they were praying for me. There was some health issues going on. And she said, I just came from the doctor, and I just got a clean bill of health, amen. So when we come together in prayer, prayer does something. God's hand moves as we cry out to him. So I just recommend, whatever you're facing this morning, whatever you're going through, join us for prayer. Prayer changes things, amen. We also have our youth nights on Tuesday nights at 7 p.m., as well as our young adults ministry. We meet every Wednesday at 7 o'clock for Bible study, as well as on Friday nights at 7:30, and we'll be going to in-person services as well. So we recommend coming out and joining us for those services. God has been on the move, amen. I also want to thank you for your contributions to the church, to God's house, right? When you give your tithe and offerings, it's not to us, it's to God. You give to God. You're being obedient to what he's called us to do. I'm going to be reading out on Malachi 3 this morning, verse 8. And this passage touches my heart very much because there was a time in my life when I was a Christian, I wasn't tithing. And I realized at that time that I was lacking in a lot of areas in our life. Bills weren't getting met. Rent was a struggle to get paid. And then I came across this passage, and it really touched home. It says, "Will a mere mortal rob God, yet you rob me? But you ask, how are we robbing you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me." Wow, we're robbing God when we're not giving him what he's asked us or called us to give. We're literally stealing from him. Then he says this, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me." And this is the only place where God ever says to test him. "Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessings that there will not be room enough to store it." And it is so true. There was a Zelle payment that went into my account last weekend, and I ended up calling up the person and saying, "Hey, you know, you sent this Zelle payment. Was it on accident?" And the person said, no, Pastor Tony, you know, God just placed it on my heart to give that to you. And I was, like, so appreciative. But I say that to say this, is that I've been a tither, faithful, and I love giving to God, not to pat myself on the back whatsoever. But I love to give to God because he takes care of me. He takes care of my family. My bills are paid. Rent's paid. And then there's always a little extra to go do something fun with the family. And that's so amazing. So what I'm saying this morning is if you're not tithing, test God. You know, test him. When you send in your 10% and say, "God, I'm testing you in this. And I promise you this right now, that God will throw open the floodgates of heaven, that you won't have enough room to store it." And he says it. Test him in it. Let's pray this morning. Father, we're so thankful for what you have given us, Lord God. You've given us our jobs. You've given us our positions, oh God. You've given us everything that we have, and we're so thankful. We're so grateful for that this morning, Lord God. Lord, I pray over this tithe and offerings, Father God, that your hand would bless it. Bless the givers, Father God. Bless their homes, Father. Bless their families, Lord God. And even those who are having trouble, Father God. I pray that you would just increase their faith, Father God, to trust you, that you'll be in control of their finances if they would trust you with that 10%, Lord. And we thank you. Let it be more than enough for us to do what you've called us to do, the work of God, Father, in our city, Father God. And we thank you. Bless it, Father God, and bless those, Father God, who are watching this morning. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Now we're going to be moving into our worship service. Do whatever you need to do. Stand up. Get ready to sing unto the Lord. Let's have a great time in worship. Amen.
Then sings my soul.
awesome time of worship, amen. I love to worship the Lord just to sense his presence. Well, this morning, I just want to jump in our message this morning. It's so exciting to be here on Pentecost Sunday. Something great to celebrate as the church was transformed on this day. I'm going to be reading out of Acts 2, 1 through 4, and verse 11 as well. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like a blowing wind, a violent wind, came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Isn't that amazing what God can do? He changed people, and he allowed them to speak in other tongues. And verse 11 says this, both Jews and converts to Judaism, the Cretans and the Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Imagine that, just being out there, listening to this, to these people speaking in tongues, and then it's in your language, and they're glorifying God. They're declaring the wonders of God. Isn't that amazing? This is amazing time in church history. It brought forth a change in the future, for the future of Christianity. This was also a promise that Jesus had given to his disciples and to each and every one of us. John 14, 15 through 17 reads like this. If you love me, keep my commands. And I love this. I'm going to be touching on this in just a moment. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and to be with you forever. See, he sends us, verse 17, the Spirit of the truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he is with you and will be in you. See, God gives us the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to live in us forever. And he says that here, to be with us forever. Amen. This is exciting because we get a helper straight from the Lord. The Holy Spirit is here to guide us, to speak to us in moments that we can't explain, or when we're in the need of something. Or I remember one time too, I was in prayer and I was going through something. I just couldn't pray, but I began to pray in tongues. The Spirit helps me to pray. And today you and I, we need a helper because we're living in a dark, dark world. I can't believe how dark our country is right now. We have taken God almost out of everything. Our country reminds me of Sodom and Gomorrah. And I can't even watch the news anymore because I get sick to my stomach. I just can't believe what is going on in our country. I was reading an article just recently on the Similac formula that they make the milk powder for babies. They're now putting puberty blockers in the formula for transgender babies. I can't understand this and I can't comprehend it. But they're taking God out of the children. They're allowing these kids, these babies, to be transgender. So if God says this baby is born a boy, that they can change, they can alter that. Oh, what a dark world we live in. See, the world hates God. Satan hates God. And what he's trying to do is to turn everybody to hate God. Also, the world is creeping into our church. I have said this time and time again. We can't tell the difference anymore from the believer and the non-believer. I've spoken to people who are okay with living and believing like the world, going against the word of God. And I cannot imagine how this breaks God's heart. Oh, it breaks his heart. See, God loves you and I so much that he did something that you probably wouldn't do, and I know that I probably wouldn't do either, is give up our children for somebody else's sins. If you look at verse 15 from John 14, Jesus says this, if you love me, he says it right there, if you love me, what comes next? If we love him, what? We will keep his command. Do we love Christ this morning? Are we keeping Christ's commands? See, only you know that. Do you love Christ when no one else is looking? In the quietness of your home, when no one is around, do you love Christ? We can only pretend for so long. You and I need to realize that when no one else is looking around, Christ is there next to you. He's sitting with us. He's watching everything that we're doing. He's listening to everything we're saying. He's watching everything we're watching and listening to. There are angels that are writing in books everything down that you do. What are you surfing on the web when no one's around? What are you doing in secret that no one knows about? What are you talking to that brother or sister about? Can I just say this, that God knows everything? Are you living a holy life? Because today, holiness is no longer a fashion of the church. I hear my wife, she grew up in church, and her dad was a pastor, and we talked about stuff that happened long time ago on how the church was just so hard on, like, not watching these movies and not doing that. And today it's like free. We're a free for all. Are you in relationship this morning with Jesus Christ? I want you to know this morning, that it breaks God's heart for us not to follow his commands. You want me to tell you why it breaks his heart? It's because he knows what it leads to. And he loves us that much that he does not want us to suffer. Get this. God does not want you to suffer. He doesn't want me to suffer. He doesn't at all. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. See, Jesus knows this, that sin leads to death. But hold on a second. I'm not just talking about the obvious sins, the big sins that people would talk about. I'm talking about the ones that much of us don't talk about. Gossipers. Liars. Greedy people. People who steal, the person who is proud, wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11 reads like this, or do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Wrongdoers, the Bible says, not me, not Pastor Tony. Scripture says this, wrongdoers. Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, people who steal, the greedy, are you greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, are you talking bad about somebody? That's a sin. When you're talking bad about somebody, that's a sin. Nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Now that's not my words. Those are words straight from Scripture. See, if the devil can lead us into sin, hatred, wrongdoing, then he has done exactly what he wanted to do in our lives. And if we allow him, he wins. Because it pulls us away from the Lord. John 10:10 reads like this. The thief comes only to steal and to kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. The devil's here to kill, steal, and destroy. That's what he's here. He's here to kill everything that God is trying to do in our lives. He's here to steal our joy, our happiness, everything that God wants you and I to have. He's here to take that away. Jesus Christ says it right there, that he comes to give life, and he promises that we will have it to the fullest when we serve God, when we do what he's asked us to do, when we follow his commands. We will have his promises to give us life to the fullest. You and I will have it. Can I ask a question this morning? Do you want to have a wonderful life? Do you want to live in peace? Do you want happiness? Do you want the joy of God? Then you have to have relationship with Jesus Christ. You need to give up your life. You need to give up the things that satisfy you and not satisfy the Lord. Luke 9:23-25 reads, then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Oh, it's hard to take up your cross daily and to follow him. It's hard. But he gives us promises that when we do that, listen to this, for whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Lose it. You're going to lose everything in your life. Not material stuff, but you're going to lose those selfish desires. But whoever loses their life for me will save it. And what he's talking about is if you live according to biblical principles, according to his commands, you will save your life from hell. What good is it for someone to gain the world? The greedy people who want a large bank account, the big house, the nicest cars. They gain the whole world. They gain it, the popularity, the money, the fame, but yet lose or forfeit their very self. Because at the end of it, we can't take this stuff with us. We can't. They forfeit themselves to hell. You and I need to deny ourselves. If we gain the world, we will forfeit our souls. But Jesus says, if you lose your life for him, you will save it. We must keep his commands. We must deny ourselves. We need to take up our cross. We must live a life of holiness. Our text this morning is going to be out of 1 Peter 1:16 through 21. I'm going to read that, and then we're going to go into a few points this morning. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, "Be holy because I am holy." Since you call on the Father, who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. Oh, I love that. I just love that. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. I love this passage, but I want to point out a few things that Peter talks about here. Peter points out to us to live a life of holiness. Verse 14, Peter tells us, do not conform. Do not conform, do not become, do not act like, do not become to the evil desires you had before you were saved. He's warning us this morning about our old lifestyles. See, some of us got saved, but we act the same way we did before we got saved. It's like nothing has happened within our souls. We've come to Christ and says, God, change my heart, but we are still acting the same. You're still cussing. You're not forgiving. You're angry. You claim Jesus Christ, but there is no change. You still want to act worldly Monday through Saturday, then you want to come to church on Sunday or worship with your hands raised. See, he sees our hearts. And I've been there. I've been there. It's hard. It's hard. You've come to Christ, and he doesn't expect us. Let me just say this. He does not expect us to change everything overnight, because it took time for us to get to where we were at when we came to him. But we should do everything in our power, our soul, to become like Christ. Romans 12:2 says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do we do that? Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. How do we do that? How do we be transformed by the renewing of our mind? Well, we come into the presence of God daily. We open our word and we read the word of God, and we let it penetrate our hearts, our minds, our souls, and that brings change about in our lives. See, verse 15, Peter is telling us to be holy in all we do. Peter says, be like your heavenly Father. Pattern yourselves after him in all that you do. Literally in every day, every moment, every thought, every action, we should see Christ in your life. You see, it's the nature of children to imitate their parents, and it's so true. It's so true. Sometimes, if you want to know how a parent is, you can look at their children. We should see the delight in being like God, because he's our Father. And because his moral excellence is beautiful and desirable, to be like him is the best way to be. See, it can also help us remember how good and loving and just and holy God is. He loves each and every one of us. He's a holy God. But also to remind ourselves, if Jesus were in my shoes, he wouldn't do this. In your everyday lives, we should be, you know, they used to have those bracelets. What would Jesus do? In every action, the way you talk, the way you act, it should be Christ-like. How would Jesus act? How would Jesus represent himself? The recipients of this letter knew that the Roman gods were warlike, adulterous, and spiteful. They knew that the pagan gods were bloodthirsty and promiscuous. So Peter says, your God is holy and just. Imitate him. Since you call on a father who judges each man's work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverent fear. That's verse 17. God is impartial, penetrating, absolutely honest judge. 1 Peter 4:17 tells us that God's judgment will begin with the family of God. He says to be like strangers here, not to be doing what everybody else is doing. But I think it's likely in the verse that Peter is not just talking about the future judgment at the end time, and he's not, but God's daily weighing of our actions and thoughts. Listen to this. God both blesses and disciplines Christians according to their conduct. He does. He blesses you. God absolutely blesses us. But he also disciplines us according to our conduct. And we're told that the healthy outcome of knowing that God is examining every action that we take, every thought we think, is reverent fear. See, for I believe that if we don't act in a godly manner, God will bring discipline, consequential, into our lives that will correct us. And it's so true, because I've seen it in my life time and time again. I would come to church on Sunday mornings. I would. And I was trying, but I would just leave campus, and I would become that worldly guy again. I was Christ-like for a few hours during service, and then I would drive off campus and be that same guy. And then I would wonder, when I was going through stuff, when God was disciplining me, oh, it hurt, but I would blame God instead of realizing that he was trying to get my attention, because he knew the road that I was on. I've seen it in time and time again in Christians' lives, who were taking the low road, and God would discipline them, and instead of taking that discipline, they would get mad, and today their lives are a mess. See, we have to come to Christ. You and I have to know that he's our Savior, and that when he disciplines us, you know, I love my kids, I love them so much, but I do discipline my kids. My daughter, she gets disciplined. She'll get something taken away, because I want her to know that there are consequences when you do something wrong. And that's the same way God is with you and me. There are consequences when you and I do something wrong. But that's because he loves each and every one of us when he brings in his discipline. Colossians 3:5-6 says this: put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Put it to death. Put it to death. Sexual morality. Put it to death. Impurity. Put it to death. Lust. Put it to death. Evil desires. Put it to death. Greed. Put it to death. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. The Lord is warning us today to turn from our evil ways and to live a holy life. And he tells us this because he knows that his wrath will come. He knows what this brings upon our lives. See, Peter reminds us that the price and plan of our salvation, verses 18 through 21, in this text, Peter reminds us of the highest motive for living, holy living, is our salvation. And he reminds us that the price that Jesus paid, the word redeemed in verse 18, is lost on us today. But when this passage was written, there were probably 60 million slaves throughout the Roman Empire. That's just crazy. A slave could purchase his or own freedom if they collected enough funds. Redemption was a precious and costly thing. It is. This passage reminds us that we were slaves to the empty way of life handed down generation after generation. See, Peter's witnessed firsthand Jesus' death on the cross. He did. A slave could be redeemed by money, but no amount of cash could set a lost sinner free. Jesus shed his precious blood for us. He gave his life as a sacrifice for you and me. Let's remember that. He gave what he did on the cross for you and me. It was a sacrifice. We put him on the cross. See, Jesus paid such a high price for our freedom. Why would we want to go back into slavery? He went to the cross for you and I. But we keep putting ourselves back into those positions that we were in before we knew Christ. See, when tempted by a sin, remember the price that Jesus paid to bring your freedom. Remember the pain that it brought him. Him going to the cross. Him being beaten. Them not being able to recognize who Jesus Christ was when he was at the cross. One of my favorite movies is Passion of the Christ, but man, it's hard to watch. Because they got as close as they could. But the Bible says that you couldn't even recognize his face. I can't imagine. But see, he did that for you and for me. Without a blink, he went to the cross. He knew what he was paying for. He knew what he was doing for you and me. 1 Peter says, he was chosen before the creation of the world, but revealed in the last times for your sake. In other words, this was no afterthought. God always knew what he was going to do for you and me. God didn't slap together some contingency plan. Our salvation was so great. It was part of his eternal plan. I love how the Message Bible translates that part of scripture. It says it costs God plenty to get you out of the dead end, empty-headed life you grew up in. And that's me. Oh, only if you knew how I grew up. Oh, only if you knew the sin that reigned in my family. Only if you knew the things that we did as a family. Only if you knew. But see, Jesus Christ did, and he says this. It costs God plenty to get you out of that dead end, empty-headed life you grew up in. I was headed to death. And the verse goes on to say, he paid with Christ's sacred blood, you know. He died like an unblemished sacrificial lamb. And this was no afterthought. It wasn't an afterthought. It wasn't like, oh God, what am I going to do? No, no, no. God didn't say, oh my God, what am I going to do? No, no, no. He knew what he was doing. Even though it has only lately, at the end of this ages, became public knowledge, God always knew what he was going to do for you and me. He knew what he was going to do. Jesus Christ knew what he was going to do when he went to that cross. The more we continue to sin knowingly, according to Hebrews 10:26, eventually there is no sacrifice anymore. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of truth, no sacrifice for sin is left. That's what Hebrews 10:26 says. There's nothing left because God has come and come and come and come. And we've just failed to obey his commands. See, there are things that are happening in your life right now that if you were to turn yourself to Jesus Christ, God would take care of it. The mess you're in, he would take care of it. I made a mess of my life time and time again, even as a Christian. But when I turned back to God, he came and he cleaned up my mess. He loves to clean up messes. According to Hebrews 6:6, we also put Christ again on the cross with our repeated sins. Hebrews 6:6 reads like this out of the NIV, and who have fallen away to be brought back to repentance, to their loss, they are crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting him to public disgrace. Oh, but we say we love God. I say I love God, but I continue to sin and I continue to put God back on that cross. Oh, I love him. I love him. And the sacrifice that he did for me to put himself on a cross that I may be free from hell. Today I try to do everything I can. I was there at one time, though. I would continue to sin, and go repent. But I kept putting, and I realized every time I would sin, I would put him back on the cross. When you're cussing, you're putting him back on the cross. When you're slandering somebody, when you're talking bad about somebody, you're putting him back on the cross. When you're taking that drink, you're putting him back on that cross. When you're having that conversation out of your marriage with that opposite sex, you're putting him back on the cross. We're putting him back. Every time we sin, we put Jesus back on the cross. And it breaks my heart to know that you and I, we keep doing me, myself. Every time I sin, I put him back on the cross. But see, he knew all along what he was going to do. Holiness demands our separation from the world. And sin to live life of purity before and for our Creator. We need to separate ourselves from the world and sin. There are people that you're talking to that you're around today that you need to let yourself go from, because the devil is using them to continue to draw you into the world. See, we need to live a life of purity so that we can stop putting them on the cross. This morning, there's not one in this room. There's not one watching by the way of TV, computer, however you're online, that is clean. You and I are nothing but filthy rags. I'm a filthy rag. We all fall short of his glory. We need Jesus, and that is why Jesus Christ had his Father send us a helper. We can't live a life without Christ's help. We live in a sinful world, a world that draws us in. This world is blinded by their will rather than the will of the Father. This morning, God has given you and given me a way out. He is a just God. Psalms 11, God is a righteous judge, a God who displays his wrath every day. He does. But I'm also so thankful. Let me just say this, that we serve a loving and gracious God. No matter what you've done, no matter where you're at today, God loves you. He loves you with all his heart, and that is why he went to the cross. I want you to know that. He loves you and I so much that he went to the cross so that you can be free, so that I can be free. Not only did he go to the cross, but he sends us a helper, the Holy Spirit. See, the Spirit of God on the day of Pentecost fell on 3,000 people, and it fell in the room, and they were transformed. But 3,000 people were saved through the work of the Holy Spirit. People's lives were changed. Hearts were changed. The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and make you remember all that I have told you. John 14, 26. Romans 8, 26 reads like this: in the same way, the Spirit also comes to help us, weak as we are. I'm weak, and I can't. I get up every single day. I get up every single day and say, God, I can't do this. I can't do this without you. I'm a weak person. But see, he helps us as weak as we are. See, the Holy Spirit is here today to help you and me live a life of holiness. God knows what holiness leads to. It leads to an everlasting life with him. But he also knows what a life of sinful nature leads to. It leads to hell. This morning, do you need the Spirit of God to bring change in your life? Because we cannot continue to live in sin and expect God to bless it. We can't. The time is now. I want to close with this. Tomorrow's not promised to you or me. It's not. And if you're not living a holy life, hell is our destination. If you're not living in relationship with Jesus Christ, hell is your destination. And I'm not talking about a religion. I'm not talking about coming to a Sunday service and doing and getting a check mark. No, I'm talking about a relationship with Jesus Christ Monday through Sunday. See, when we come to church, we should be fed up already. We should come excited to worship God. Hell is a real place, and the Bible mentions it many times. See, hell was not only for the devil and his fallen angels, but because the devil has blinded so many people to the truth of God, that is where people end up. And that is his goal, because he hates us. When you're a child of God, he hates you. The devil hates you, and he wants to turn you and send you to hell. But sadly to say, this is where many people who call themselves Christians, who attend church, will end up. Yes, they will end up in hell. Matthew 7, verse 20, through 23 reads like this: Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will inherit the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, but only the ones who does the will of my Father who is in heaven keep his commands. If you love me, he says, you'll keep my commands. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons? And in your name perform many miracles? Then I would turn, tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. See the key verse there is, I never knew you. It's about relationship with Jesus Christ. What am I saying this morning? The time is now. The time is now to serve God. The time is now to live a holy life. The time is now to surrender. The time is now to lay your life down for Christ. Repent. It's time to love the Lord for everything that he's done. Tomorrow's not promised to you or me. Turn to God. See, this morning, what we have to do, what we've been called to do, is to follow Jesus Christ and his commands. And you'll have a great outcome. This morning you might be in fear. You might not have peace. But see, if you're in relationship with Jesus Christ, yes, those things still come. But the faith is there. One of my favorite scriptures, for God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of love and a sound mind. He gives us a sound mind. So that fear, that anxiety, is not from God. But when we turn our lives to him, and we say, yes, God, I surrender to you this morning. Would you surrender? You may be a Christian and following Christ, but would you surrender? Would you just surrender all this inside and just say, God, here it is. You know, I've been attending church, but I haven't been acting right. I haven't been acting like a true child of God. Would you surrender this morning? God loves you, and he loves me. And he wants us to live a life abundantly to the fullest what he has called us. And he loves us so much that he went to the cross so that you and I can have life. We can have peace. We can have joy. We can have happiness. We can have all that his promises have said. But this morning, we need to turn to God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning, especially for Pentecostal Sunday, Lord God, where you've sent your spirit to an upper room, God, that transformed Christianity, Father God. We thank you so much for sending each and every one of us a helper, Lord. It's a promise to live a life according to biblical principles. Because it's hard. It is hard to live according to biblical principles, but you send us the helper to help us. Your word even says that not one is perfect, only Jesus Christ. And we are so thankful that Jesus Christ went to the cross on our behalf. This morning, Lord, we surrender to you everything that's in our hearts, Father God, that is not aligned with your biblical principles, Father. If we have greed, anger, hatred, lust, any of that, we give to you. And we ask you to cleanse our souls. Cleanse our souls, God. Cleanse our hearts, oh God. And we thank you. I pray this morning, Father, that everyone watching this morning, that you would touch them, that you would touch their homes, that your presence would fill their houses right now, Father. And we're so thankful. We're so grateful that we have access to the King of Kings. We have access to a God who is alive. You're alive. And we thank you. And we give you glory. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen and amen. Well, it was so good to be with you on this Pentecostal Sunday. You have a blessed day. Tune in to next Sunday's message or come visit us on campus. God bless you. Have a good Sunday.